Hi, I'm Marge Easley with the League of Women Voters. The League is a nonpartisan organization that has provided voters with unbiased election information since 1920. We've invited candidates to talk with us so you can learn more about them. And joining us now is Mitch Greenlick, candidate for Oregon House District 33. Nice to have you here, Mitch. Thank you.
Hi, Marge. Thank you for having me.
You're very welcome. So you've been around for quite some time on the legislature. You 16 years. And what I know that healthcare is one of your passions. Is what committees are you sitting on currently?
Currently, I chair the Committee on Healthcare of the House. I sit on Judiciary, which is a great committee to be on. And I also serve as the chair of a committee that I hope never meets. I'm chair of the Conduct Committee of the House. In my three terms as chair, I fortunately haven't had a...
That's wonderful.
...had to call that committee together.
Good, good. Well, let's start with healthcare, and I know it's a passion of yours, and there have been a number of healthcare bills that have come up and a healthcare measure. Tell us what you're looking forward to. What's going to be on your agenda?
When I joined the legislature in 2003, 18% of Oregonians had no access to health insurance. We're now, through a lot of the things we've done over the past 16 years, we're down to about 5% of the population. I'd like to move that toward universal access to care in the next session. It probably depends on what's going on in Washington, D.C., where Medicaid and Medicare and Social Security have been under attack. But basically, we're going to try and deal with the incremental increases in insurance in one way or another in the next session. I've got a task force working on it right now, and they'll be reporting in October.
Okay. All right. Do you feel that the federal situation and the attacks on health care benefits is going to impact what Oregon is able to do?
Well, it probably depends on who's in control of the U.S. Congress. If the Democrats are in control of one of the houses, at least it may stop that, or at least slow it down until after the 2020 election. But I think we need to move ahead and improve our healthcare system independently of what's going on in Washington. We did the transformation that created the CCO movements for the Oregon Health Plan. I think we've done a great job in managing the Oregon Health Plan. Now it's time to create a new, dynamic, fantastic medical care system in Oregon, and I intend to start that push in the next session.
Okay. Now, a lot of folks feel that closely tied to health care is climate change, because there are some health issues related to rising temperatures and environmental issues. How important is climate change on your agenda?
Well, I think the whole question of the environment is very high on my agenda because of the nexus between environmental degradation and health effects. For example, diesel emissions has been very much on my agenda. I've had bills on trying to create more clean diesel activities in the state, and I hope we can move in that. But the whole climate change issue is, it's important to all of us, because I have three great-grandchildren now. I'd like to leave them an earth they can live in.
Exactly. And I know another interest of yours is education. And right now, Oregon's high school graduation rate is still pretty low. And what initiatives are you supporting going forward to raise that and to make our system better?
Well, I'm particularly concerned with higher education, but the real point is not everybody's going to go to college. So we need to have lots of opportunities to train our workforce. We need to have much better access to community college. I believe we should have free access to community college for kids coming out of high school, both as a way of easing into university, taking a couple of years at the community college and then moving to university, but also as a way of having job training. A couple of years ago, the average age of people going into apprenticeship was about 25. So you wonder what happened to those people between the time they graduated from college and they got into an apprenticeship. There have been, I think, great things going on to link community college to high school in a much better way. That's very important. We also need to get the cost of education under control, because when the state reduces the amount it spends on education, the tuition burden on families goes up.
Right.
And I've looked at the cost of education, and it hasn't increased by anywhere near as much as the cost of tuition has increased.
Yes.
So we're putting more burden on middle-class families to get their kids educated. We need to take that on. Oregon deserves, every one of those Oregonians deserves an opportunity to have the education they need to get ready for their career.
Okay. And do you have any particular thoughts on going, mandating a 180-day school year?
I don't have thoughts on that. I mean, I'm not pushing on that by itself, because in order to do that, we need to make sure we put money into it. And while I haven't seen a tax I don't like, not everybody in the legislature feels exactly that same way. So if we mandate a 180-day school year, which of course from an education perspective is important, we need to have the money that goes with it. I'm looking forward to the report of the joint committee that's going around the state now, looking at the question of what makes student success, and hope they'll come out with some proposals that we can all get behind. It is a bipartisan, bicameral effort, and I hope they'll lead us in the right direction.
I'm looking forward to seeing what they've come up with too. Right now, it seems that homelessness and affordable housing are two issues that have really come to the fore. What are these areas of things that you're concerned about too? And if so, do you feel that we're on the right track?
Oh, I don't think we're on any track right now. This is an extraordinarily important issue. It's not only a practical issue, it's a moral issue. My district office is in Old Town, and I have to walk by people sleeping on the sidewalk, and it tears my heart to see that. I think it affects all of our quality of life to have hundreds and thousands of people sleeping out on the sidewalks. It's heartbreaking for me. From a healthcare perspective, it's a very important issue, because you can't possibly treat people either for mental health issues or for physical health issues if they don't have a home to go to.
Right.
So it's very high. We're working on social determinants of health nowadays, and homelessness is one of the really critical issues. So I don't see a simple solution to it, but everything we do, I know Speaker Kotek's been working very hard on this issue. We have an initiative on the ballot as an important initiative for housing. It's critically important issue.
It's just hard to stay on top of it. That's the issue. We only have a very short time left. Is there something you want to say as far as why voters should elect you for another term?
Well, I think I've done a great job in my terms. I work very hard for my constituents. Once you get elected, it becomes a nonpartisan office in a very real way, and you have to take care of the 60,000 people you represent and the 4 million people of the state. So I think I've been a good steward, and I hope they'll send me back for one more term, which will be my last term.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for being here. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.